Good morning, brothers and sisters. There anybody around you you would like to say welcome to? I don't know if there are people coming for the first time. I can't see anyone, but if you're downstairs and you're here for the first time, you're welcome. Everyone is welcome to this place we call church, the house of God, and we are the church. Yes, we are the church. So you're all welcome. Welcome to us. Welcome to the church. Pastor Zach will continue his discussions on the Holy Spirit today. And I'm just so excited because the Bible says the Holy Spirit is the helper. And today he'll be telling us how the Holy Spirit goes to the very root where we need the greatest help. The only barrier that stands between us and God is sin. S-I-N. And so the Holy Spirit goes to that very root and breaks the power of sin over us so we might please God. Can we now stand for our Psalms? This morning will be from Psalm 65, and we'll do it as we do. What mighty praise, O God, belongs to you in Zion? Though we are overwhelmed by our sins,
you forgive them all.
you faithfully answer our prayers with awesome deeds. You are the hope of everyone on earth.
Even those who sail on distant seas,
You form the mountains by your power.
Arm yourself with mighty strength.
You quieted the raging oceans with their pounding waves.
Silence shall be.
Those who live at the ends of the earth,
stand in awe of your wonders.
From where the sun rises to where it sets,
these fire shafts of joy.
you take care of the earth and water it. The river of God has plenty of water. You drench the plowed ground with rain. You soften the earth with showers.
Bless abundant crops.
You crown the year with plenty. The grasslands of the wilderness become a lush pasture. Together, the meadows are clothed with flocks of sheep, and the valleys are carpeted with grain. They all shout and sing for joy. Amen. Amen. I welcome my sister for the doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. So do we remain standing to sing the hymn? Okay, so the seat man's now.
Oh, yeah.
We're going to sing a song about love divine, all loves excelling. And I will say that if anyone would like to do music with us in the future, we try to arrive here at about 9:15, and I can share the music in advance with you if you'd like to see it. I play the guitar, and playing the guitar and singing at the same time is complicated if I don't know the words or the music very well, and many songs are new to me, and so I welcome anyone who wants to help us with this, from here or down there. Thanks for singing and joining us.
It's 56 if you want to join us.
Yeah, 56 in the hymn.
From this blue hymn now, you can, if it's not in front of you, it will be at the back somewhere. 56.
Okay.
Let us pray. O God, you know our deepest griefs and our highest hopes. Meet us in this moment and help us to open ourselves to your work of healing and transformation. Let your spirit move freely, not only in this space, but in every corner of our lives. Equip us to embody your grace and courage. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Great. I understand there was a delicious breakfast downstairs this morning, and there will be a breakfast next Sunday. Feel free to join us starting around 9:15-ish. There should be some lunches to go. Maybe I see a thumbs up. All right. So some lunches are being made up downstairs now. If you want to take one after the service with you,
feel free to go downstairs and grab one. You can keep up to date with what's going on here in the corner of Garland and East 3rd by going out to eastdaytonfellowship.org. Click on calendar on the top, and I added some slides today. If you go out to eastdaytonfellowship.org, this is the first thing you'll see. Click, there's the word calendar up there. You click on that calendar and you will see this. This is what's going on this week. Now, I'm sure you can all read that from there, but that's right. If you prefer a different view, you may click on, like, up there it says week, and I'll show you what that looks like. I did not show you what the month was, but once we go to week, if you prefer that view, you may get that view. So that's how you can keep up to date with what's going on here. And what's going on here this afternoon, right after this worship service in that back room? Zach is leading a teach and talk. How should Jesus' disciples relate to contemporary politics? Yes, he's going there.
Nonpartisan.
This is nonpartisan. It is a generic. How is Jesus' followers, should we, well, as he says, should we relate to politics? And so our denominations come from an Anabaptist background. And he's going to introduce you to what the Anabaptists have done in the past. Spoiler alert, some of them say don't vote. Come find out why some say that. And some have changed over the years to not saying, no, we do need to vote. So it's more like, what should we be doing in this political environment? It's not who to vote for, what to vote for, who not to vote for. That's not it. But what should we be doing in this situation? There's pizza provided. Ah, all right. So after worship in that back room, if you're interested, you have plenty of opportunity to volunteer here on this corner in Dayton. Tuesdays at 4 o'clock, Wednesdays at 10 o'clock. Down, both of those are in the basement to help get the clothing closet ready for Fridays, part of the Friday ministries. You can also come on Fridays, but sometimes the Tuesdays and Wednesdays can be a little more helpful just because it's not as chaotic. Soccer, I'm guessing it's a good soccer weather day. 4 o'clock, Washington Park at the end of Garland Avenue. Come play, come watch. And then you have a couple of prayer opportunities during the week. On Wednesdays from 1:30 to 2:30, on this level in the church, actually, it might be downstairs sometimes. It's downstairs now. But look downstairs. If you don't see them, come up here. There's an opportunity for prayer, study. I hear that group is becoming quite the interesting group. So if you want to take place in some spiritual refeeding during the week, Wednesdays at 1:30 here in the church building is a good opportunity to do that. Another opportunity is Thursdays starting 12:30 is one where you have an opportunity to pray for the community. The group will start here at the church at 12:30 and then walk through the community praying for the community. So those are the announcements for this week. Not now. Leads us to our offering time. God has given us a myriad of gifts. I like that word, myriad of gifts. Energy, compensation, companionship, possessions, time. So in our own way, each of us now, let us return a portion of that blessings to God. So what is it we each have to return to God? As I said, some of those gifts we include time. And so maybe it's giving of your time to the church during the week, whether it be to be in prayer, to volunteer. Or maybe you, some of your gifts have been possessions or financial resources. Well, then you can give back in a manner through the offering plate this morning. Or maybe a word of prayer has been put on your heart and you want to lift up a silent word of prayer to God during this time. Or maybe you want to write it on a card that's in the black back of the pew and place it in the offering plate. So just as we have a myriad of gifts, there are a variety of ways we can give those gifts back. So let us pray for the gifts we are about to receive. Oh God, as we bring our offerings, which are symbols of the power of this world, infuse in them the power of your world, the power of love. Through your blessing and our willingness to share, may these offerings become a source for hope and love in this church family and in the community beyond us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would the ushers please come forward?
Spread the tidings round. Wherever man is found, wherever human hearts and human woes abound, let every mortal tongue proclaim the joyful sound. The Comforter has come.
Hello. Good morning. Today's reading is from John 3, 1 through 8. And there was a man named Nicodemus, a Jewish religious leader who was a Pharisee. And one dark evening, he came to speak with Jesus. Rabbi, he said, we all know that God has sent you to teach us. Your miraculous signs are evidence that God is with you. Jesus replied, I tell you the truth. Unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. What do you mean? Exclaimed Nicodemus. How can an old man go into his mother's womb and be born again? Jesus replied, I assure you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of the water and the Spirit. Humans can reproduce only human life, but the Holy Spirit gives us both birth to spiritual life. So don't be surprised when I say you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it wants, just as you can hear the wind, but you can't tell where it comes from or where it's going. So you can't explain how people are born of the Spirit. And Nicodemus, on a side note, I had to look this up real quick, but he's in a painting called The Disposition of Christ. And it shows him, he was a skeptical person of Jesus actually being the Son of God. And then by the end of it, he was the one that was taking him off the cross, and he bought like 75 pounds of ointment and got the burial ready for him and everything. So if he can change Nicodemus's mind, I think we can all do the same.
James. Praise God. So our Bible, what do you call it? Scripture for the week is taken from John chapter 3, verse 3. So we'll say the verse together and then recite it twice. So let's go. John chapter 3, verse 3. Jesus replied, I tell you the truth. Unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. One more time. John. Jesus replied, I tell you the truth. Unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. This is probably one of the most important passages in the scripture. So I'm going to tell you what went through my mind as I meditated on this passage. The first thing is that Nicodemus was a Pharisee, a teacher of the law, probably PhD in theology. You know, was a very smart man. Yet he did not know the basic thing that he should know, that Jesus ended up telling him. First thing, therefore, in my mind is who you are does not necessarily determine what you know. In actual fact, if we read 1 Corinthians 1, 26 to 29, this may look like a sermon. It is not. It is my meditation. It says, brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. So here we are, PhD theology. He didn't know the basic things that the fishermen and, you know, the other followers of Jesus knew better than him. So it's not who you are that determines. In actual fact, you know, as I was thinking about it, I said, let's go to the streets and tell the people, you know, because there are those who, because of their lowly estate, feel that they can't come to God. In actual fact, probably the lower you are, the more likelihood that, you know, the embrace of God is going to come quickly.
The other thing that came to my mind this morning, not this morning, as I meditated over the week, is that you do not become a citizen of the kingdom because you were born in the kingdom. You will become an American citizen if you are born in the US, even if it's by mistake, you know, like your mother came in and then suddenly you came out. you know, you become a citizen, but that's not the way it is with the kingdom. You must claim citizenship of the kingdom. You don't become a Christian because you are born into a Christian family. No, you become a Christian because you have claimed, you know, the citizenship. You have become born again supernaturally. It could be on your own, quietly on your knees. It could be, quote unquote, by force, like, you know, Saul, before he became Paul, when he was on the road to Damascus and God encountered him. It could be others, you know, praying with you. But by and by, what God is, Jesus is saying here is that there must be a conscious decision by every person to make Jesus the Lord of their life. Now, when I was younger, I'm still young, it's just the ER that is not there anymore. I used to watch a comedy, I think it was on black and white, the Flip Wilson show. How many of us? Yes, thank you, my sister, because they may say that means not telling the truth. So that's my witness. The Flip Wilson show. But there's a way he dances in, I won't dance it because I'm on the pulpit. You know, he was one of those who popularized this statement, the devil made me do it. In fact, the most popular one for me was, you know, he acts as Geraldine. And then Geraldine bought a new dress. Meanwhile, Geraldine had so many dresses uncountable. And then this guy was asking her, Geraldine, why did you buy this new dress? Said, the devil made me do it. And said, but how did the devil make you do it? Said, well, you see, I went to the shop and I was, you know, looking through the dresses. And then the devil said, go inside the shop and buy the dress. And I said, no, I don't want to buy the dress. And then, you know, long and short, I said, the devil pushed him into the church and put a gun on her head and said, buy the dress. And then she bought the dress. The devil made me do it. One of the things that happens to us when we are in the kingdom is that the devil no longer has power over us. And part of how that happens, apart from the Spirit of God that's in us, is that as we live and fellowship with fellow kingdom people, God grants us the grace to, Zach is already here, God grants us the grace, you know, to help each other in this journey. So as we are in the kingdom, two things quickly in 2 minutes. Don't forget that church is too important to miss. Once you begin to miss church, you are beginning to step, knowingly or unknowingly, out of the kingdom. Church is so important because it gives us accountability. It helps others to look into our lives and say, what you are doing is wrong and what you are doing is right. Once you are in the kingdom, you no longer have the right to say, this is my business. It is not your business. It is the business of the kingdom. Buying dresses like Geraldine did is nothing, but not entering the kingdom prepared by Jesus is a big deal, probably the biggest deal you and I will ever encounter. Thank you very much. Zach, I'm very sorry.
All right. Well, brothers and sisters, we are continuing this sermon series on the Holy Spirit. We've asked in depth the question, you know, who is the Holy Spirit? We talked a little bit about who we are related to the Holy Spirit. We've not plumbed the depths of that question. I mean, you could spend a year of sermons on the Holy Spirit. You wouldn't exhaust the topic. But we talked about the fact that we are temples, and not just like our bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit. And we explored that. Today we're going to talk about what the Spirit does. And again, we're not going to exhaust the topic in this sermon. In fact, that will be this heading for the next several sermons. What does the Spirit do? And even in the 3 or 4 sermons we end up preaching on that, we won't exhaust it. But we're going to start with an absolutely critical, beautiful scripture. A scripture that means a lot to me personally and made a big impact on me. Like, I don't remember my experience of reading every scripture for the first time. I have made it through scripture all the way multiple times over. My sister Linda maybe is going to catch up to me one of these days. She's not here this morning, but she's churning through the good book. Yeah, but like there's lots of scriptures when I read them, you know, I have no memory of what was it like when I first read this? What experience did I have? What did I think? I remember when I first read the scripture that we're going to look at today. I remember what I was thinking, the effect that it had on me. This is a beautiful scripture, and it's one that's very meaningful to me specifically. We're going to be reading the end of Romans 7 and the beginning of Romans chapter 8. Now, fair warning, Paul is not the easiest biblical author to understand. He gets excited. In this passage, he gets excited. And he kind of is talking rapid fire at various points. And he's a great thinker, and there's a density to his thought. And so he's packing lots of ideas in to a really short amount of words. And so we'll do our best to kind of unpack things as we go. But the amount we're reading, we won't unpack everything. But I'm going to try to hit a couple really important, crucial, big, and beautiful ideas that are here, ones that are essential for all of us in our walk as Christians. So first, let me read the end of Romans 7. I'm going to read from verse 14 through verse 24. I'm going to comment maybe a little bit as I go, but also kind of try to sum things up at the end. We're going to have a problem very clearly set up for us in these verses. And it's a problem that I imagine all of us know very, very well. So Paul, verse 14, chapter 7 says, "So the trouble is not with the law, for it is spiritual and good." He's talking about God's law. Things like the Ten Commandments, right? Don't kill, don't steal, don't lie, that stuff. That's good and spiritual. "The trouble is with me, for I'm all too human, a slave to sin. I don't really understand myself." Pay attention there. Somehow sin is bound up with this question of self-understanding. Paul says, I don't understand myself. I'm a mystery to myself, and not in like a good way. We're going to see what he means by this. "I don't really understand myself, for I want to do what is right, but I don't do it." You know this problem. I know you do. Because I know myself, and I know every other person I've ever gotten to know well. You've had this experience where you believe this is right, this is good, and you don't do it. And then you don't do it again. And then you don't do it again. And you keep not doing it, even though you love the idea of doing it. I want to be that kind of person. I want to have that kind of way of talking, that way of relating. I don't, and yet you don't do it. "Instead, I do what I hate." Have you ever hated a thing you keep doing? A way you keep speaking to somebody, a way you keep avoiding something or somebody, something you keep ingesting, keep taking into your body. We're a church with lots of people that have a history with physical addictions, chemical addictions. But this is not just the territory of people with chemical or physical addictions. This is a human problem. Addiction is one subtype of this. But there is nobody, no matter how squeaky clean they like other people to think they are, that doesn't know this problem inside out firsthand. If I know what I'm doing is wrong, this shows that I agree that the law is good. Right? We have these times where it's like the problem isn't that we don't know what we want to do and what we should do. That's not the problem. Sometimes that's a problem. Sometimes we're in a situation where it's like, I don't know what the right thing to do is. That's its own kind of problem. But a lot of times it's not that we don't know what the right thing is. It's that we know it and we might even want it, but we keep not doing it. We keep doing the opposite. We keep doing something we hate that we do. We know it's wrong and we don't even enjoy it. I mean, that's definitely, my addict friends who've had those chemical addictions know this full well, but I think all of us would know this full well. There are times when that thing that you hate that you keep doing is not, you don't even enjoy it, and you're doing it anyway. And that shows, Paul says, that really I agree the law is good. I agree the law is good, and I know that in my mind, but this is not what's playing out in my life. So I'm not the one doing wrong, says Paul. It is sin living in me that does it. Now, remember what he said at the beginning of this paragraph. He said, I'm a slave to sin. The essence of slavery is that you're under the control of an alien power. And so he's saying, in this experience, I'm not in control of myself. Self-control is one of the fruits of the Spirit. That's listed in Galatians 5. But we have, all of us, this experience where we're not under our own control, that there is this alien power at work inside of us that gets us doing what we hate and gets us running away from what we love, and we are powerless against it. We are controlled from the inside, but by an alien power that's taken up residence inside of us and running our life for us. That's the essence of what it is to be a slave. And so we find that we are slaves of this kind. Paul goes on, he says, I know that nothing good lives in me. That is, in my sinful nature. I want to do what is right, but I can't. I want to do what is good, but I don't. I don't want to do what is wrong, but I do it anyway. But if I do what I don't want to do, I'm not really the one doing it. It is sin living in me that does it. He's made that point twice. Those two paragraphs basically perfectly parallel one another. And it's a pretty good measure of the importance of something for any writer, including a biblical writer. If they keep repeating something, that means they think it's pretty darn important. And it's pretty darn important to Paul that we get this concept that there's a fundamental human problem here, and it is one that we live under the control of something alien to us apart from the help and the grace and the freedom that God brings us in Christ. That I'm a slave to sin. I have discovered, I'm at verse 21, I have discovered this principle of life, that when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what is wrong. I love God's law with all my heart. But there's another power within me that is at war with my mind. This power makes me a slave to the sin that is still within me. Oh, what a miserable person I am. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death? Who will free me from this miserable life dominated by sin and death? It is miserable to be in that place, to keep doing what you hate doing, to keep running from the good that you love. I relate so deeply to what Paul says there when he says, I love God's law with all my heart, but I don't do it. That is agony to be in that position. And it's quite possible. See, there's more at work here than just what you want. You can want with all of yourself, with all my soul. Paul says, I love God's law. With all my soul, I want to honor him. And yet that's not enough. I am bound by chains. I'm fettered. And I lack the freedom I need. I lack the power I need because I'm under some other power greater than me. there's so much power in that portrait. It resonates so deeply in me because I've lived it. And you, I believe, have lived it. Now, I told you I remember what I was thinking when I read this passage for the first time. I would have been right about 14. I was 13 or 14. I think I was 14 and I was a new Christian. And I was reading through scripture for the first time, devouring it, actually. I couldn't get enough of it. I was just reading scripture. And I came to this passage and I was a new Christian. And there was, to this day, there's still lots wrong with my living and my life. And there certainly was even more then. And I remember reading this and going through chapter 7 and being like if a doctor gives you a diagnosis, it starts to be like, yes, this is it. There's got to be a cure, right? And in fact, this question, right, that Paul ends verse 24 with, who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death, right? I was getting excited because I was like, this is me. How did Paul know, right? You have this like, this is exactly it. And I was getting so excited because I was like ready for the answer. I was ready to know, okay, how can I free myself? And that's how I was thinking. How can I free myself from this condition? How can I stop being so miserable in this way where these things that I keep doing that I don't want to do? And I couldn't wait to hear what it is. I was like, Paul's going to lay it out for me. It's going to be great. I'll know what my step one and step two and step three is to get well and to get better and to get victory. I couldn't wait. And so I kept reading. And let's keep reading. Verse 25. This is what Paul says. Thank God, the answer is in Jesus Christ, our Lord. So you see how it is. In my mind, I really want to obey God's law, but because of my sinful nature, I am a slave to sin. Thank God, the answer is in Jesus Christ, our Lord. So now when I read this for the first time, I'm really salivating. And, you know, I was a new Christian, but I wasn't so new that I didn't expect the answer to involve Jesus. I definitely expected Jesus was going to be part of the answer. And so I was eager to keep reading. Okay, lay those steps out for me. What's the answer? How can I gain this freedom? What do I need to do? And I kept reading, and I have to tell you, though I now regard these verses as some of the most beautiful and sublime in scripture, when I first read them as a 14-year-old, they were a big letdown to me. And I'll tell you why. But let me read them first. Let me read verses 1 and 2 of chapter 8. So now, there is no condemnation for those who belong to Christ Jesus. And because you belong to him, the power of the life-giving Spirit has freed you from the power of sin that leads to death. These two verses were not what I wanted or expected to hear as a 14-year-old new Christian. Because I was expecting to be given a roadmap. First, what you got to do is this. You need to, you know, maybe it's a simple, okay, read your Bible 1 hour every day, then say this prayer 10 times, and then make sure that you do this, and then make sure that you do that, and that I'd have a system that I could work that would make me free from the power of sin over me and in me. But instead, what Paul says is the beginning of my freedom is not anything that I do, or anything I control, or anything I can affect. There are three things Paul mentions. The order he mentions them is slightly different from their logical order. The first thing he mentions is there's no condemnation for those who belong to Christ. So the belonging actually is the second word mentioned, but it's the first reality. Our freedom from the power of sin begins when we are made to belong to God. Our ownership is transferred. We have been slaves. We have been under an alien power. But Christ breaks the fetters and brings us home. and home with him, belonging to him, there's no condemnation that touches us. We're forgiven completely and fully in advance. When Christ died for you, he already knew all your sins. He already knew the worst you would ever be and the worst it could get. And you're already washed and you're already clean and you're already whole because of his blood over you. If you have accepted his embrace, if you've said, I'll come home with you, Jesus, I belong to you. And so now I'm clean and now I'm whole. And 14-year-old Zach is thinking, okay, great, I'm forgiven, but what about the getting better stuff? Like, what am I supposed to do? And what I didn't understand now, but what I understand now is that Paul then says, right, that he doesn't say that for those who belong to Jesus and for whom there's no condemnation, for them, the power of the life-giving Spirit has freed you from the power of sin that leads to death. Who is it that gains victory over the power of sin? Who is it that begins to do what they love and to avoid what they hate? Who is it that can change? Is it the person that in anxiety has to think they need to earn their place at God's table, earn their place in the home of God, the house of God? Or is it the person who already knows that no matter how bad I screw it up, I am always welcome in the home of the Father? And that in fact, the absolute unquenchable power of his love and his forgiveness, the knowledge that I cannot forfeit his love unless I want to literally throw it away. But no amount of screwing up, no amount of sin, no amount of time. You're still struggling with this? Nothing can separate us from the love of God. And it is that security of his unquenchable love that actually creates the right context for the healing of what's broken inside of us and for the learning of the way of Jesus. If you learn any way, if you learn a trade of carpentry, how to build watches. My brother builds mechanical watches for a watchmaker. If you need to learn the way to live from Jesus, it takes time to learn these things. And you know what is really not conducive to learning anything that's hard to learn? Anything that you have to retrain your limbs, your fingers, your eyes, your perceptive capacities? Anxiety is going to destroy your capacity to learn. If you're always worried that my place is, I'm about to lose it. If I don't perform, I'm going to be kicked out. You're probably not going to perform real good. I mean, there's some people that can perform under pressure, but anxiety is inversely proportional to how you're going to do. But if the Father brings you in and says, you're my child, and my son died for you, and you will never lose your place in this school of discipleship. And you can fall on your face and make a fool of yourself 1,000 times, and I will still reach down and pick you up and say, no, son, no, daughter, it's like this. And he'll keep saying, it's like this, until you get it. It is our acceptance by God, our unconditional acceptance by God, that frees us from the fear of death, from the fear of loss, from the fear of messing up and of not being good enough. And it frees us from that anxiety so that there is room in our hearts for the Holy Spirit to change us, transform us, and train us in the ways of Jesus. I was expecting a manual on how to control myself with procedures and methods. And instead, when Paul said the answer is in Christ Jesus, he said, you're unconditionally loved and accepted by Jesus Christ. If only you will say yes to him. If only when he says, come home with me, I say, okay, I'll come home with you. That's it. The only thing he asks is that you say yes. You can fail and fail and fail. But if you know that you will be accepted, and that you are accepted and that you are loved, there is room for the Holy Spirit then to do what only the Holy Spirit can do, to change you. Paul brings this home in the coming verses. So let's keep reading. Verse 3 and verse 4. I always get behind on my own notes. The law of Moses was unable to save us because of the weakness of our sinful nature. The NLT, which is what's in our pews, and what I'm reading from, the words sinful nature there, the literal word there is flesh. We're going to talk more in a minute about what flesh means, what this word sinful nature means. Flesh, sinful nature, it's the same underlying word there. So shelve that for a minute because it is important and it's an important concept. But basically, we find ourselves in a condition where knowing what's good isn't enough. That's his point. He made that earlier, but he's reiterating it here. The law of Moses isn't enough to save us because of the weakness of our sinful nature. It's not enough to know what's good. It's not even enough to love what's good. That's not enough. So God did what the law could not do. He sent his own son in a body like the bodies we sinners have. And in that body, God declared an end to sin's control over us. He paid a price. That was in Paul last time about our bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit that he bought with a price. You don't belong to Satan. You don't belong to sin. You don't belong to the grave or to death. You belong to God Almighty. And he paid a good price for you. And so you owe no debt to your old masters. You can walk right out the door. The prison gates have been unlocked and opened. He declared an end to sin's control over us by giving his son as a sacrifice for our sins. He did this so that, and I've put my own translation of this verse up there. This is verse 4. He did this so that the goodness of his law would be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. He bought us and forgave us so that we could become truly good. So we could do the good that we always wanted to do but never could. The point of forgiveness is to lead us to obedience. We don't obey in order to earn that forgiveness. It just won't work that way. And yet so often we live with anxiety about God and about our place in the church and about our place in the world. Do I matter? But what Paul says here is that God died for us, forgave us, loved us. Elsewhere he says this, while we were still his enemies. It wasn't that we hadn't earned it. It's that we were working against him. That's when he died for us. That's when he suffered for us to buy us back because he knew that only with that free, absolute, unconditional love, given while we were still enemies even, only then would we be secure enough in his hand. Only then could we really be assured of our place and our value to him, that then we could change. Then we could change because we'd be safe, safe in his hand. No enemy could take us out. No failure could take us out. And so bought by him and loved by him while still his enemy, safe in his hand, there we can be changed by the power of his Spirit. So important that we understand that we change by being loved and accepted, by belonging to God. The belonging, the acceptance, the love, and the forgiveness come first. And then as we sit in his love, as we luxuriate in his forgiveness, as we find our way belonging in his family, we are changed over time by the Spirit's work within us, unhurried, because we're safe in his hands. Reading on, verse 5, those who are dominated by the sinful nature, think about sinful things, but those who are controlled by the Holy Spirit think about the things that please the Spirit. So now we are getting a little bit more of a description about how that change works. It presupposes, it depends upon us being forgiven, us belonging, us being accepted. that is what will lead. But then once we belong, once we're forgiven, once we're accepted, how do we actually start to change? What starts changing in us first? And actually what he says here is that our patterns of thought will begin to change, because the Holy Spirit is there. The job of the Spirit is to draw our thoughts and our ways of thinking to coordinate them with and make them match up with the Spirit's ways of thinking. There's a word in the original language here, the Greek, that could easily be translated as frame of mind. Like that basically what the Holy Spirit does is he starts changing our frame of mind. That as the longer we sit in our forgiveness, in our belonging, in the love of God, the more our frame of mind is changed and our patterns of thinking begin to change in ways that start to then change the way we live. As anxiety disappears, all of a sudden, I make decisions differently because I'm not driven by that anxiety. As fear disappears, as envy and jealousy disappear, as misbegotten desires, desire for wealth, desire for the wrong kinds of connection, as those desires begin to melt away and we begin to learn how to, part of our frame of mind is what do we desire? And as those begin to change, we'll make different decisions too. That outwardly we're changed from the inside out. As the Spirit changes our thinking, as we sit in the love of God and belong to him and dwell in his home. Paul goes on, Romans 8:6. So letting your sinful nature, your flesh, it's every time you hear sinful nature in this translation, the literal word is flesh. So letting your sinful nature control your mind leads to death. But letting the Spirit control your mind leads to life and peace. For the first time, there's a mention of something you or I can do. Up till now, this has all been Jesus, the Father, and the Spirit. He died to buy you. He bought you. You belong to him. You're forgiven. Thanks be to God. There's no condemnation. The Spirit is drawing your mind. Here, though, the question is, okay, what can you do and what can you not do? You can let the Spirit work or not. There is a choice there. I can either cooperate with the Spirit who wants to draw me into the frame of mind that Jesus had. Paul said elsewhere, let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. So I can either cooperate with the Spirit in doing that, or I can delay. I'll still be loved and forgiven and accepted, but I'm going to suffer a lot more if I don't cooperate, because what God wants to do is give me a new way of thinking and therefore a new way of living. And so you can let the Spirit draw you. Let go of those old ways of thinking, those old preoccupations. Let them go. Let them go so that you can become new. And then verses 7 and 8, and these are the last two verses I'm reading, and I'm going to use these to explore this flesh versus spirit, spirit nature thing. Verses 7 and 8, for the sinful nature, that's the flesh. The sinful nature is always hostile to God. It never did obey God's laws and it never will. That's why those who are still under its control can never please God. So this is like he's kind of noting something that it helps explain the way all of this works that we've been talking about. So I'm gonna end on that note, and I think it's a helpful one. He says that this sinful nature, again, the word here is flesh, is always hostile to God. Now, you guys might remember that last time we were talking about our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit. So flesh here, this word flesh, is actually different from the word for body. There's two words in the New Testament, and they actually don't just mean the same thing. The word for flesh that Paul's using in most of this chapter, and it's always a negative for him, doesn't just mean having a body. Paul doesn't think, and God doesn't think, that our bodies are bad. He made them. They're amazing. In fact, we're told that our body, and the word here is soma in the Greek. So our body, our soma, whenever Paul uses the word soma, it's usually translated body. And Paul says lots of beautiful things about our body, including that it's a temple of the Holy Spirit and that it's a gift of God. And so your body is a beautiful, wonderful thing, and it's a gift, and it's holy, and it's good, and it's not always hostile to God. But then there's this other word, sarx, and that's the word for flesh. And it's not in the New Testament simply a synonym for soma, for body. This refers to the way that our body works when it is driven by misaligned appetites and instincts that are out of sync with our Creator. Flesh names a way of inhabiting our bodies. It names the way that appetites and instincts that remain unbaptized and untrained and unsurrendered in our bodies can lead us astray. So the examples that I've used in the past, when I talk about, okay, so like when we're threatened by others in some way, our untrained instinct is the fight or flight mechanism. And I've talked about this in various sermons before, right? Either I fight back and I hurt if I get hurt, or I run away. But Jesus says, oh no, I'm not going to do either of those things. And I'm going to teach you how to not do either. Neither to fight back and give hurt for hurt or run away. My way takes courage, but it also takes control. It takes a transformation. My way is the way of the cross. If you strike me on one cheek, I will turn the other. I'm not going to run away and I'm not going to fight back. I'm going to stand here and assert my dignity. The great African-American theologian Howard Thurman wrote a whole book called The Jesus and the Disinherited. He was like a mentor to Martin Luther King Jr. and others in that movement. And he was a Christian minister and a profound thinker. And his whole book, Jesus and the Disinherited, was what does God want the oppressed and the persecuted to do? And he was talking to his fellow African-Americans in an age where they still had been deprived of many of their rights in our country. And he said, he doesn't want us to hate our enemies. And he doesn't want us to cower and to just be doormats. Instead, by calling us to crosses, we are doing a few things. We're overcoming evil with good. And we are asserting our own dignity. When I turn the other cheek, if I cringe and run away, I'm giving into and letting their violence against me define me. But when I stand there and look them in the eye and say, oh, you want to do that? Okay, you can hit the other cheek too. It actually enrages abusers and persecutors and those that commit injustice when those who suffer it are not cowed by it and don't run from it, but also then don't resort to the same violent tactics. It does infuriate them and because it shows up how thin and how stupid and how ugly their injustice is. And so Howard Thurman said, so here's what we're summoned to do. Jesus made it pretty clear. It's just, we don't want to do it. We are called to turn the other cheek and to carry our crosses and to show up their evil for what it is and overcome it with good. But see, no normal human instinct does that. The turn the other cheek is not an instinct you're born with. It won't be. Dami said there's no born citizens of the kingdom. There's nobody born with that instinct. Fight or flight are the two instincts. Turning the other cheek, carrying a cross, that's not an instinct you're born with. You have to be given that instinct. You have to be reborn as a son or a daughter of God and grow up to learn how to follow his instincts, how to carry your cross that way. And so our flesh, our fallen bodiliness is going to want fight or flight. But we can learn how to live in our bodies differently. We can learn to inhabit our somas, our bodies, with bravery and sacrifice. So brothers and sisters, let's sum up. What does the Holy Spirit do? In our verses today, we have learned that the Holy Spirit binds us to Jesus. And he reassures us that we belong to him. In fact, as I move towards closing, I want to read for you a few verses later in this chapter. Listen to this. This is the word gospel means good news. This is good news. Therefore, dear brothers and sisters, you have no obligation to do what your sinful nature, your flesh, urges you to do. For if you live by its dictates, you will die. But if through the power of the Spirit you put to death the deeds of your sinful nature, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. So you have not received a spirit that makes you fearful slaves. Church, hear this. You have not received a spirit that makes you a fearful slave. Instead, you have received God's own spirit. You are a temple of the Holy Spirit, right? When he adopted you as his own children, and when did he adopt you? When you were still his enemy, when you were still spitting on him. The Roman soldiers who crucified him, Jesus said, Father, forgive them. We were crucifying him. Our sins crucified him, and yet he said, I love you. No, he adopted us as his children when we hated him. And we are now adopted. Now we call out to him, Abba, Father. For his spirit, what does his spirit do? His spirit joins with our spirit to do what? To affirm that we are his children. What does the Holy Spirit do in our lives? He binds us to God, our Heavenly Father, and he reassures us, you are the child of God. You are not a slave. You are not powerless. You are not worthless. You are worth the life of God. He gave up his life to purchase your life. You have his power at your disposal. You are not just a child, but an heir. You are valuable to God Almighty. The Spirit reassures us of our acceptance, our belonging. He reassures us of the love of the Father. He surrounds us in that love so that there is created around us the atmosphere we need, the space we need to truly change. And then when we are dwelling in the love of the Father, when we are abiding in the love that Jesus called us to abide in, then he begins to work within our minds to draw our thoughts away from fleshly concerns to spiritual ones, to change those patterns of thinking and even of instinctual response. Your instincts can change. You know that? The instinct to run or to fight can really become the instinct to stand and turn the other cheek. And the Spirit will do that. And your choice is, do I let him? Do I cooperate with the Spirit? Or do I hold on to my old ways? And finally, we're told, since we are his children, we are his heirs. In fact, together with Christ, we are heirs of God's glory. But if we are to share his glory, we must share in his suffering. We, brothers and sisters, if we will share in his suffering, because it's hard to change. And it's hard sometimes to accept his invitation to change. But if we are willing to follow him in this, he frees us to live true and beautiful lives. If you live by the dictates of your flesh, you will die. But if through the power of the Spirit, you put to death the deeds of your sinful nature, you will live. He is offering us life. Life as it is meant to be. Life that is full of goodness and power. Life that is ours because our place in his family is secured for us forever by Jesus. Let me close with this reminder. Who can free me from this body dominated by sin and death? Thanks be to God. The answer is in Christ Jesus, my Lord. It's in him, not me. I am so glad he made me a part of the family of God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for loving me when I hated you, for loving me when I run away from you, when I fall short of your love, when I sin and screw up. Thank you for loving me more than I know or imagine. Thank you for making me belong to you, for adopting me. Thank you for doing that for every person here. I pray, Lord God, we would not stay far away outside the celebration in your home the way the elder brother did in your story. Help us come home and come in to your warm embrace. You offer it to all of us. And sitting at your hearth, eating at your table, basking in your unconditional love, may we feel our minds being drawn away from old patterns into new ones. May we be transformed by the renewing of our minds, set free from the power of sin and death in order to live true lives, full of holy boldness, full of righteousness and justice, goodness, full of love ourselves. I pray this gift for every one of us. May we all be changed from one degree of glory into another as we turn our faces toward you and bask in your loving acceptance. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, in and through the power of the Holy Spirit, our comforter and counselor, to you, our Abba Father. Amen. Brothers and sisters, would you stand with me? And we're going to sing, "Breathe on Me, Breath of God." And yeah, Old Testament choir or any others that want to help sing, come forward at this time. And I don't have a handout, so we'll just look at the little screen.
Breathe on me,
breath of God. Fill me with life anew. That I may love the things of and do what you would do. Breathe on me, breath of God. Fill my heart with spirit. Fill my wings. Is one with yours to do and to endure. Breathe on me, breath of God, till I am wholly thine. Until it's only part of me close with thy fire divine. Breathe on me, breath of God.
Amen. Amen. Brothers and sisters, I'm going to send you out today with the blessing that's become my go-to, and it's especially fitting given our message today. Hear these words from the book of Hebrews. Now may the God of peace, who brought up from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of his sheep, and who ratified an eternal covenant with his blood, may he equip you with everything you need for doing his will. May he produce in you, through the power of Jesus Christ, every good thing that is pleasing to him. All glory to God forever and ever. And the church said, Amen. Go in his peace. If you want to stick around for that teach and talk, we'll start back there in a little while. The pizza is going to show up around noon.
All right, guys.
Okay. So, come by.
And also the yard sale, I wanted to make an announcement if anybody was to donate, because I'm pretty much going to give it all. Thank
you. Well, we can make an announcement.
Yeah, we have to break into
people. Yes. Okay, so I'm thinking that, like, but yeah, leave it in there and I'll let them know
it's there. Hi, good to see you, Carter.
Nice to see you.
You can try talking. It's going to be hard. It needs you to be really close to hear you.